Right, thanks, Nino. And actually, we can kill several birds with one stone here because I'm not really doing this on my own. Although only one of my co-investigators, George Brown, is here today, I'm sure Jess and Megan are with us in spirit. So I would like to acknowledge the vast amount of work they put into making this particular, I suppose, pair of projects happen. I should also say that this talk is a dry run for a conference paper that we're giving in Edinburgh next month. That explains the length of the abstract. I don't know how many of you made it to the end of that, but it was designed with that particular meeting in mind. It's a satellite meeting of the workshop on sound change, which I've heard is an excellent conference. I still never managed to get to one. And this is a satellite meeting called Innovative Methods in Sociophonetics, organized by my colleagues Anne Fabricius in Denmark and Nikolai Freo, actually also in Denmark, but at different institutions. We should also acknowledge the generous funding of the ESRC and the Wolfson Foundation. George has a scholarship, advanced quantitative methods PhD studentship from ESRC, and Jess, when she was a PhD student, was funded by the Wolfson Foundation, very prestigious award, very rare to get one of those. She's gone off now to work at JP French Associates, the private forensic speech and audio lab across town. And Megan is doing other things in Bristol now, but I do hope she will come back and do some PhD research because she's very, very good. Was an undergraduate of this department and then a master's student, MSc in forensic speech science. Okay, well, enough about that just now. When I'm, I guess, in my day job, a lot of what I do involves the analysis of accents and dialects of English. I'm interested in variation in other languages as well, but English is my principal focus. And we all know, I think, that accents of English and other languages can vary at lots of different levels, phonetic, phonological levels. There's all sorts of things going on at the segmental, the subsegmental level, the suprasegmental level, all kinds of variation in different dimensions. And as analysts, we tend to pay attention to the really noticeable, the conspicuous stuff. The differences between varieties, that's what makes them sub-varieties that are distinct from one another, after all. But I think it's true to say that we pay a lot more attention to the things that stand out, the really noticeable differences, the salient features. And Carmen and I have been working on research that is seeking to try to get a handle on what perceptual salience, or socio-phonetic salience might actually mean. But very often we default back to standard varieties of the language we're looking at, or if there isn't a standard variety, at least something sort of mainstream. Everything's anchored on the properties of that privileged kind of variety. So for British English, what we used to call received pronunciation, many of us still do, of course, also known as standard Southern British English, and general American English, broadcast English for the US context. And we relate the variation that we see to what obtains in the phoneme inventory of those varieties and how those map onto the lexical sets, which we can denote using slightly more user-friendly labels like the ones that John Wells invented, fleece, goose, kit, and so on. So this is the kind of diagram you'll see in some of the reference works on the topic. This has been distilled down, the very large amount of phonological variability, phonetic variability in varieties of English. This is mainstream non-Caribbean varieties, according to Trudgill and Hannah. This is their book, from their book, International English. And there you can see that the major sub-varieties of English around the world are defined by, well, actually, just vowels plus R plus T. Those are the only variables that are mentioned. And those to Trudgill and Hannah and lots of the rest of us who work in this field seem like intuitively sound ways of dividing up the dialect continuum of English. This comes from a book that I co-authored, the Accents and Dialects, English Accents and Dialects book with Peter Turgill and Arthur Hughes. And there's a matrix of features here. Each of the named varieties there has a unique combination of plus and minus signs according to the variables that you see at the top there. Again, mainly vowels, but some consonants in there like presence or absence of non-prevocalic R, roticity, in other words, presence of H, presence of a G at the end of a word like sing or sing, yod, and so on. So not exclusively vowels, but that's where a lot of the variation, of course, resides in the phonology of the dialects and accents of English. And so you can abstract from that, or you can represent the same information using a map like that and say these are the main sub-varieties in the British Isles. But I think I've already suggested, planted the seed at least, that this selectivity is also a bit subjective too. Would there be benefits to looking at accent variation in a more holistic way? So looking at varieties in the round rather than picking sub-features and focusing our attention on those. Well, there's different ways we could do this. We could firstly expand the range of variables that we look at, but that could take a long time if we carry on using the traditional methods, and we might not get a lot of return for the amount of time we invest. We could automate some of the work that we do, and you may or may not be familiar with the FAVE package provided by the University of Pennsylvania. I understand, incidentally, I just learned within the last few days that there's no longer any support available for this facility. When it was up and running and being supported, absolutely marvelous thing. I'll describe how it works in just a second, but Selena's been wrestling with it for the last few days and has found that actually it's you can't any longer use it as a web-based application. You have to download code and so on to get it to work. So that's kind of unfortunate, I think. It looked like that was going to be a really innovative way of doing this kind of work, but you've been left to your own devices now if you want to do it. You want to use these scripts that have been provided by the Penn Group. So what is FAVE? It's an acronym meaning forced alignment and vowel extraction. It's actually two programs that run in parallel, or sequentially rather. What you do is you submit your audio file and an accompanying orthographic transcript, send it off to the servers in Philadelphia. And the first of the two programs, FAVE Align, will perform what's known as forced alignment. I don't know how many of you know what that term means. You have an audio file, you have a text file, and what the program does is try to line those up such that it says, this is the k at the beginning of the word cat, this is the vowel in the middle of the word cat, this is the t at the end. And it'll segment your file and return to you a Pratt text grid file with word and segment tiers for each of the speakers in your recording. So that's really handy, really convenient. Seems to work very well from the feedback I've had. Designed for English and specifically American English, though I should point that out. FAVE Extract, the second of the two programs, that will then do some formant analysis for you. It'll find all the vowels in your recording on the basis of the what came out of the forced alignment procedure, and we'll measure the first and second formants at the temporal midpoint of each and every vowel. So that's the sequence, if you like, down the side, and this is what the end product can look like. So this is a recording of somebody called G. Salvi. I don't know what the variety of English in question is, but as you can see, you've got this enormous pile. I don't know how many thousands of measurements there, all done overnight, essentially. So these are the raw figures on the left represented in a program, again, a freeware package, only available for Mac OS, unfortunately, called Plotnik, which Bill Lebov himself programmed. It's got some peculiar features, so if you decide you're going to download and use it, be warned, make sure your speakers are switched off, because it makes very funny noises as you boot up. Demonic laughter. I've never understood why. Anyway, so you can take your Hertz data and then apply a normalization process, very simple one, just converting your raw data into Z scores, and you'll get some indication of the distribution of points on the F1, F2 plane relative to what other speakers do. But we're looking at tens of thousands potentially of measurements where, you know, if you wanted to do those by hand, you'd be there for a very, very long time. Months and months and months doing that. This will do it overnight for you, or as good as. So those are two possible solutions. The third one is we just change or augment the way we do things by applying procedures which are just qualitatively different, not more of the same, but something different. You could argue that FAVE just does more of the same. It's just that it's much more productive in terms of output. You get much bigger volumes of data. This is big data now we're talking about. It's reproducible. You'll get exactly the same figures if you do it twice. It's very transparent. You can download the code and inspect that if you know what you're looking at. So in that sense, it's much less black boxy than a lot of people have suggested. I mean, FAVE is actually the opposite of a black box, in as much as it's much easier to recover how the data have been arrived at than it would be if you were trying to find out that information from a human analyst who might not do the same job twice in exactly the same way, even on the same data on consecutive days or even consecutive hours. So this is less black boxy. I completely agree with what Joe Fruwald, who's one of the originators of this program, has argued in defense of the use of FAVE. So what else have we got in our toolkit? Well, there's lots of other forms of spectral analysis that you could apply. It's not really been used very much in sociophonetics yet. But one very commonly used technique in other areas of the speech sciences is the conversion of your audio signal, your digital signal, to units known as Mel frequency Kepstra. And you can, from those, you can derive a set of coefficients which describe the properties of your data in a very reduced and parsimonious way. Those are known as MFCCs, and they're very commonly used in speech technology applications, speech recognition in particular. So all those smartphone apps that you've used that have speech recognition, Siri and so on, at least their forebears, their forerunners, would have used MFCC-based analysis. The inheritor of this strategy is a technique known as iVectors, which I guess George and Vince are more expert on than I am. Anyway, MFCC is very commonly used. What you do is you slice your speech signal into very, very short duration time slices, you know, in the order of tens of milliseconds. So you're dealing with units which are much shorter than the segment. They're little, tiny little snatches of acoustic information. And then you can boil those down using the, focusing on a subset of the coefficients that you derive to what's known as an MFCC vector. So a string of 12 numbers. 12 is a fairly standard number of values to have in the vector. So it's pretty abstract compared to the kind of analysis that we would tend to do as human analysts. This is something that only machines can do. And as I say, it's been proven to work extremely effectively in speech recognition. It really is a very solid and reliable workhorse in terms of deriving useful, meaningful information from even quite bad quality recordings. In the forensic domain, there's been more of a move towards the incorporation of automated methods. So you'll have heard, if you've been coming to some of the colloquia recently, about ASR, automatic speaker recognition systems, which are already in use in some labs for forensic speaker comparison. The Nuance Corporation, who this department has a very close relationship with, just in terms of supporting some of the training we do for MSc students or for external organizations, have really mopped up all the competitor packages that were out there at one time. So they bought up the Loquendo engine and much more recently the Batvox engine produced by a group in Spain. So they really are the major player now in this area. They provide other tools in their forensic speech analysis oriented software suite. One is called Identifier. The idea is that police officers, security personnel, can actually have a copy of this software running on some device that they carry around in their pocket. And that will, the principle goes, send a voice sample off to a server somewhere. Comparison will be run, and a message will come back to the cop out there on the street to say, we think the person you're talking to might be Mr. or Mrs. X. Please behave appropriately, or you know, arrest them, or whatever the message happens to be. Okay, so this is all happening now in real time. It's not a case of taking recordings away to a lab and poring over them for weeks on end. So one way that these systems could be applied is not specifically for speaker recognition, speaker identification as it's sometimes called, but also speaker classification more broadly. What kind of accent does this speaker have? That could be the question, not who is this person? Is this person known to the authorities already? Those sorts of questions, but what kind of accent does this person speak with? And this is where George's YACTist system comes in. The name and the underlying architecture are inspired by the ACTist system that Mark Huckvale developed at University College London. ACTist stands for accent characterization by comparison of distance in the inter-segment similarity table, and it's convenient also that ACTist looks a bit like accent distance. So I think the acronym may have been invented first, I don't know. It's rather limited in some ways though, because it's very dependent on having a text to align itself to. It's very context dependent. It demands that you have a fixed text. If you're going to do comparisons between talkers, they all have to be doing the same thing. Okay, like reading the same text passage. The way it works is by computing an accent distance score between the talker and some other data set, could be for another talker, could be for a set of talkers, by comparing the properties of individual segments which are time aligned in their sequential positions. So whatever the first phoneme happens to be in the string that's being spoken. Okay, so let's say it's the first fricative at the beginning of the North Wind and the Sun text passage, something like that. That would be compared with the equivalent phoneme from some other sample. So if you find that there are missing samples, if somebody misses a syllable, for example, misses out a word accidentally when reading, you're a bit stuck. You don't have a comparison that you can make. So that's a real limitation too. The system has been adapted and borrowed by other researchers. For example, there's a group in Birmingham who've done some work with this. Various other researchers around the world have trialed permutations of ACTist. And in many cases, they've had really good performance out of it. So they're getting 90% accuracy when it comes to accent classification. It's working very well. But it's not very flexible, as I've suggested. There's some things that's not going to do for you. And for use in, you know, forensically realistic scenarios, it's really not going to get you very far. So this was the thinking behind George's York ACTist or YACTist system. It was developed specifically with forensic aims in mind. And the way that it works, similarly to the Huckvale system, is that it'll estimate distances between speech samples on the basis of averages of MSCC vectors for individual tokens of phonemes, so the E vowel that happens to crop up in this particular word at this particular time. And then it will relate those to the averaged pattern for all the tokens of the E phoneme, the A phoneme, and you know, so on, all the phonemes in the inventory. So what that means is it can handle context-independent material. You don't have to have two people reading the North Wind and the Sun in order to perform the comparison, let's say. It'll handle different texts. It'll also handle mismatched content, so depending on what kinds of materials you have, could be a phone call, a recording of somebody talking spontaneously versus somebody reading a text in a police interview room. However, it is still text dependent in that you have to make an orthographic transcription of the material before you can do anything else. So that is a time limit that's imposed by the design. On the other hand, by departing from the original Huckvale design, you've got much more flexibility. And not least because some of the individual phonemes you're looking at are very frequent, extremely frequent, schwa in particular, far and away the most frequent sound in spoken English. So how does it work? Well, George has designed these very pretty diagrams, which I'll talk you through in as coherently as I can. So you start with the speech signal, okay, and the forced aligner will, as I said before, line up the orthographic transcript, which has been converted into a phonemic representation, and do the segmentation of your vowels and consonants automatically. That, by the way, is a forced aligner that George developed using the HTK toolkit, not an off-the-shelf one. Once you've got your audio time aligned with the text, you can then identify where the midpoints of your segments are, and you can extract MFCC vectors from those. Okay, for every single little segment in the string. There's something strange happening with my monitor, so I can't really see what's going on very well. It's flickering on and off. So then you take all your individual instances of the phonemes and you derive a mean MFCC vector, an average MFCC vector per phoneme. And we know that there aren't that many phonemes in spoken English, on the order of 44 or so. And so you end up with a set of a relatively small set of values that you can then use for the comparison. What you then do is you pair up all the phonemes that you've got. You express distances between those pairs of phonemes using a simple Euclidean distance metric. Okay, and that gives you a matrix of values for every speaker. So you've got this table of values per person. Okay, if you've grouped your speakers into accent groups, you've said he's a speaker of Newcastle English, this person is a speaker of Sunderland English or something, then you can come up with a generalized model of each of your accents. And those are fed forward into what's known as a support vector machine. In a nutshell, what happens is so you're operating in a very high dimensional space here, and the exemplars of each accent are generalized such that the distance between them and a plane in this higher dimensional space is minimized. All right, so it's like a line of best fit, I suppose, in a regression model, but you're working in lots and lots of dimensions at once. You then take your unknown talker, and what you do is you look at the distance between that speaker's model and the ones that you've generalized for each of the accents that you think that speaker might belong to. Okay, so that's where the unknown speaker comes in, and you do that comparison by essentially minimizing the distances within the SVM. Okay, I better speed up a bit. George has tested this on three corpora, which you may be familiar with some of them, you may not have heard of any of them, but these were ones that were compiled within this department. Three corpora of varieties of British English. First one, Accent Identity on the Scottish English Border, or ISEB. The second one is Jess Wormald's corpus, Punjabi English in Bradford and Leicester. And then the Northern English's corpus, which is based on recordings of people from Manchester, Newcastle and York. So let's look first at the ISEB results. So this is what YACDIST has decided on the basis of 120 speakers from this corpus from four towns along the Scottish English border: Berwick, Carlisle, Eyemouth. Oh, Berwick's in there twice, that shouldn't be right. Eyemouth and Gretna, sorry. You can see Gretna in the right place up here. So this cell down here should have Gretna written it. My mistake. The green lines on the diagonal, the green cells on the diagonal there are correct identifications, correct classifications. And you can see that it's performing really well. This is based on red speech. And only the vowels, so no consonants, and not schwa, so the vowels apart from schwa. This is one of the different ways that you can actually do the comparisons. I'm sure George will be happy to tell you more about that later if you want to know. But the red figure here is the important one. It's getting the answer right nearly 90% of the time. Given that chance is 25%, this is performing really well. These are quite similar accents of English in many ways. The area in which they're spoken is pretty small, geographically limited. Moving on to look at the Punjabi English data from Bradford and Leicester. These are people reading the same text as we used for ISEB, so it's comparable on that level. You've got speakers of Anglo-English, so people who have no Punjabi language heritage, just English, as compared to the Punjabi English group for each of the two cities. And again, cast your eye along the diagonal there, and you'll see that it's getting the answer right most of the time. This is a pretty difficult task because you're asking it to make a judgment about geographical origin, but also ethnic origin. So it's got quite a lot to be considering all at once. Same methods as before. Performance not quite as high, but still very good, massively in excess of chance. And then the third corpus, the NEC, three varieties, as I mentioned. So this is based on spontaneous speech, 10 minutes worth per person. And this is based on all the vowels and the consonants, so a really broad sweep of segmental features. And again, it's getting the answer right 4/5 of the time. So, well done, George, and your collaborators on these particular bits of analysis. All right, so that leads us on to the next question. What happens if the speaker isn't actually genuinely a speaker of that variety, but is faking it? This is an issue that comes up from time to time in forensic work. It's fairly common for people to disguise their voices. There's lots of different ways they do it. It can be anything from whispering or speaking in a falsetto voice or using some other strange voice quality, even just holding a pencil in their mouth or something like that. Very effective ways of disguising the voice. I've worked on a couple, actually more than this, but here are a couple of examples of cases I've worked on. In the first case, somebody was trying to obtain money. It was an extortion case, faking a Northern Irish accent to seem more, I suppose, more frightening, more plausible, more determined. The second one was one of those express kidnappings where somebody's whisked away at gunpoint or knife point to an ATM machine and told to take out as much money as possible. That was a case where we weren't actually sure what sort of accent the robber was attempting to do. We're pretty sure it wasn't his regular one because he didn't sustain it very long. It could have been all sorts of things. We think it could have been he was either attempting to sound Polish or what was the other one? Middle Eastern, I think. I don't remember the details now. Anyway, it wasn't very well done. That's not really the point, though. It doesn't have to be done perfectly. It just has to be enough to disguise your usual voice. There are also implications here for those of you who are interested in language analysis in the asylum process. Given that the purpose of the language screening tests that are imposed are to try to weed out the bogus claimants, the people who are faking an origin in some war zone or place that's in dire straits, there are pressures from that direction as well to find ways of weeding out the fakers. I think it's probably fair to say that as human listeners, we're very tolerant of variation in the speech of others that deviates from the pattern we would expect. You know, the accent is essentially X, but there's a few things about it that don't quite fit with my expectations. But unless you have independent reasons to doubt somebody's authenticity, you might just ignore those. You might just gloss over them. It may be that your knowledge of that accent is pretty fragmentary or vague, hazy anyway. It may be it's based just on the speech of a single talker who may, him or herself, not be all that typical anyway. It might be based on stereotypes which are out of date and almost by definition inaccurate. And I think most people understand that accents vary within themselves. You know, some people have a broader accent of type X than others, okay? So we're aware of those things. We're also aware that accents can be mixed. You know, I lived in Northern Ireland until I was 10 years old, but then my parents moved to London or something, so I sound like I'm a bit of both. We're all familiar with people like that. Nothing strange about it. And I think you'll probably have guessed why I've got these two actors up here. A lot of people don't realize that Hugh Laurie is not American because he did a very good American accent in his role in the TV series House. And Idris Elba, I hadn't heard of him or seen him in anything but The Wire originally, and I just took him at face value. I thought this guy is a native speaker of Baltimore English. But it turns out, of course, that he's a Brit. There is some theoretical help that we can get here. There are people who've worked on this topic before, and they've come up with a model that they call the cognitive impression, which speaks simultaneously to issues in production, but also in perception, because of course those two things are very tightly interwoven. I won't have time to say much about that today, unfortunately. I need to return to the question at hand, which is, how well do machines perform in competition with human listeners, even human listeners who are native speakers of the accent in question? So there's been quite a bit of work looking at the effects of voice disguise on the performance of automatic speaker recognition systems. But what Megan decided to do for her MSc dissertation study was to compare the performance of human listeners against machines directly where accent disguise is involved. So she recruited three groups of listeners, human listeners, lay people, actors and phoneticians, and looked at how they performed against YACDIST. And the task in question was to see in a set of samples of Edinburgh English, which were the real ones and which were the faked ones. Okay. This was motivated by three research questions. Are phoneticians better on the production side, are phoneticians better at disguising their accents than lay people or actors? But on the part of the listener, how does the YACDIST perform relative to the human listeners? Okay, so that's the man-machine thing, if you want to call it that. Thirdly, are some accent features more important than others? Are some more helpful to the human listeners? And I won't have time to say much about that, I'm afraid. Anyway, let's look at the listeners themselves. Megan recorded nine male speakers, three lay people, three actors, and three phoneticians. None of them was a native speaker of Edinburgh English, quite a wide age span, and accompanied those with recordings of genuine Edinburgh English speakers, one of whom was me, in fact, from a database that I compiled a few years ago. Here are some examples if you want to hear what they sound like. Okay, what do you think of that? Is that real or fake?
Fake.
Can we have a show of hands? Who says real? Who says fake? Okay, the fakes have it. What about this one?
So she was very happy to start a new job in a superb private practice in North Square, near the Duke Street Tower.
Real? Fake? All right. Nobody is, well, I guess some of you might be sure, but I think the majority of people are not very sure. And then this one.
That area was much nearer for her. And more for her to like.
Real? No. Fake? Nobody. Nobody is confident this is fake. Well, they're all fake, actually. I noticed that we have native speakers of Scottish English in the room who were taken in by these. Now, the first one was spoken by a layperson with no training, Second one by an actor with some training in accent and dialect work, and then the third one by a phonetician. And if you're very sharp-eared, you might even recognize the voice of the phonetician in question. It's Barry Heselwood. And then there was a set of Edinburgh English speakers as well, as I said, one of whom was me. So actually, I've been a little bit naughty here, and I've said that the Edinburgh speakers had no knowledge of phonetics. That was not true in one case. And I have had... Okay. So different sets of perceptual skills there. Each of the talkers read the text passage, comma, get secure, twice. Four steps involved. The speaker was allowed to familiarize himself with the text, then read it aloud in his regular accent, then listened to a recording of a conversation between two genuine Edinburgh English speakers, and then the speaker read the text aloud in an imitated Edinburgh accent. You get the idea? So stage three was a training phase. First two were to do with familiarizing themselves with the text, but this third step was the one, the fourth step was the one that we really wanted. This was administered online using Qualtrics. Each participant heard 12 samples, each of 20 seconds apiece. And the extract was, rather than saying everybody listens to the same text 12 times, there was a kind of a sliding onset within the recording, which was generated, the onset of that, the time point where it started, was generated using a random number generator. So everybody had a different bit of the text to hear. Megan randomized the order of samples and also the order of blocks. You probably can't see this very well, but this is what the on-screen interface looked like. So they would listen to the sound file, then make a simple binary judgment. Is this person a genuine Edinburgh speaker, yes or no? There was a confidence measure. I won't talk about those values today, the figures for that, but I will come back to the Likert scale down here. Please rate how true you think the following statement is for the person you just heard. The person's accent is an authentic Edinburgh accent. There's nothing to suggest that they are disguising their voice. How strongly would you agree or disagree with that? Right, now we're moving on to YakDist. There's only one YakDist. So we had 100 listeners, human listeners, but we've only got one YakDist here. So I think it's fair to give it a fighting chance and give it plenty of material to get its teeth into. It knows nothing about Scottish English, Edinburgh English in advance. So give it some training materials, recordings, six recordings of genuine Edinburgh English speakers, nine full-length imitation recordings, so that's the whole of the comma get secure text, then 90 excerpts from those, 10 per speaker, an SSB control, so that's the native accent of one of the phoneticians, okay, both a full recording and a 20-second excerpt. And that's just to see if the system's calibrated properly, it should say SSBE is miles off the chart. It's completely different from the other samples it's been asked to listen to. And then another control in the form of a sample of two samples of Edinburgh English, a full recording and the little 20-second excerpt. It's also been trained in advance on data from Glasgow, again, just as a way of seeing where the results would fall relative to another variety of Scottish English. Two ways of testing, one using just the vowels and one using the vowels plus R. And what I'm going to tell you about here is the vowels plus R. Correct me if I'm wrong, George.
I think so.
Yeah. Because both were tried. The scores that YakDist spits out are correlation scores. It's Pearson's R correlation coefficient. And they run on a scale from 0 to 1. Scores closer to 1 mean that the imitated accent is closer to the real thing. So high scores are good. In order to get the Likert scale judgments to map onto something more binary, because remember we have both, we've got the yes, no judgments, but also then the more finesse judgments about the level of agreement with the suggestion that it's a a genuine accent. Megan came up with a way of doing this which involved having four as the midpoint, the neither agree nor disagree. So anything greater than four was treated as a yes, this is genuine. Anything less than four as a no, this is a fake accent, an imitated accent. She found that the great majority of scores, 95% of them, conformed to the expected pattern, and that where responses of four were given, they were associated with the yes decision in approximately half of cases. So everything seems to be okay, balanced, and working properly. No funny stuff going on there. So four was the threshold, as I say. Right, here are some results then for the three. So if you look at this table, we've got the three lay speakers down this side. We've got the three actors and then the three phoneticians. We've got their scores there between 0 and 7, or 1 and 7 rather. Those are the possible extremes of that Likert scale. And then the rank. So the person who was ranked highest, P1, the first phonetician in the set, and I don't think I'm giving too much away to say this was Paul Fowkes, who's very good at imitating an Edinburgh accent, really startlingly good at it. So he was head and shoulders above the competition there. But this actor, A2, also scored very near the four threshold. So you can see there's quite a lot of variation in terms of the listener's willingness to say, yeah, this is the real McCoy, this is really genuine Edinburgh English. And interestingly, to go back to what I pointed out earlier, there was a difference between Scottish and non-Scottish listeners who took part. Remember, there was a group of 100 listeners. Some of them were Scots, and the Scots in the sample got the answer right 78% of the time versus 63% for everybody else. So they do have an advantage in this way, but not a huge one, really. It's only 15%. These are the scores for the real speakers, including myself, down here at the bottom, and it seems I'm the most genuine sounding Edinburgh speaker of the set. The other ones still get scores of above four, but they're not massively above four. This is a very complex and busy diagram, so I'll try and talk you through this in as clear a way as I can. Right, so we've got the four speaker groups here, the lay people, the actors, the phoneticians, and the genuine Edinburgh speakers. Four is our threshold. So genuine above the line, fake below the line. And then we've got the individual responses given by the listeners arrayed up and down each of these vertical lines here. So there you can see that most people thought that layperson one was faking it. But over here, okay, this is Paul. You can see that most people thought he was for real. They thought he was a genuine Edinburgh speaker. You can see that the line, the average line, the one that joins the means for each talker, climbs steadily from left to right, and that all the genuine Edinburgh speakers are classified as genuine Edinburgh speakers overall. But you can see that actually this speaker, RM, was thought to be faking it by some listeners. And actually the scores, if you compare his against polls, you can see that they're actually very similar in distribution. So these two speakers are borderline in a sense. Ranking as well, you can see lay people, actors, phoneticians, and then Edinburgh speakers at the top of the pile. So the phoneticians are doing the next best job and so on down the scale. You get the idea? Now this is what YACDIS does when set more or less the same task. We've taken out the genuine Edinburgh recordings, they're no longer relevant. And because these are correlation scores, rather than scores on a Likert scale like we saw before, it's more difficult to impose a threshold. It's harder to say when it's decided that, yes, it's not saying, in fact, this person is genuine or not genuine. All it's doing is returning a correlation score. So it's up to us as the user of these data to decide where that line should be. So one way of defining a threshold would be to say, at what point does it decide, or what kind of correlation score does it give to a genuine sample? In this case, a 20-second sample of Edinburgh English, and it's 0.81. So you can treat that as some kind of approximate threshold for where the bar is. And there you can see it's, for all these people who are faking it, remember, it's judging that they are, well, it's not judging that they're fake or not fake, but it's giving them, well, a wide range of correlation scores, but they mostly fall below the line, that kind of ground truth baseline of 0.81, where we know that the speaker is a genuine speaker. The ranking is a little bit different here, as you'll see. So actually, the actors were ranked highest of the three fake speaker groups. They managed to pull it off more successfully than the phoneticians or the lay people did. But it turns out there's no significant differences between the groups when the stats are run. Okay, so just returning to our research questions then. Are phoneticians better at disguising their accents than lay people or actors? The answer is yes. Overall, they seem to be, but the margin isn't a very big one. That should be two rather than one. How does Yaktus perform relative to human listeners? Well, if you correlate the Yaktus performance with the responses for the human listeners, you'll see they're actually negatively correlated, not the result we were really hoping for. It's a weak negative correlation, but it is a statistically significant one. So Yaktus is clearly doing something pretty different from what the human judges are about. When we look at the rankings for the individual speakers and compare them between the humans and the Yaktus results, so ranked from 1 to 9, you can see the ones I've picked out in green are in the same positions ranking-wise as one another. That's a nice, neat result. A2, P2, and L3 seem to be particularly consistently judged to be the most genuine sounding. But then look at P1. It's phonetician 1, this is Paul. And you can see that the humans thought, yeah, he's definitely the best, but the machine was not quite so convinced of that. L2, similarly, opposite ends of the scale, A3. So it's a mix, really, of expected results in a way, but also ones which completely overturn that generalization. Okay, so how does Yaktus perform relative to the human listeners? The answer is differently. But importantly, I think this is probably the most important result out of Megan's work, Yaktus is less susceptible to type 1 errors. It doesn't accept faked accents as genuine as often, anything like as often as the human listeners do. All right, so it's very much less error prone, which is encouraging. Okay, third research question was, are some accent features more important than others? This would require a talk on its own, I think. It's really complex. So on the left-hand column, we've got sample number. They're just references. Don't worry about those. They're not values or anything. They're just a label. And then we've got the ranking from 1 to 90 of all the individual samples. So at the top of the table, we've got the top 4 most highly ranked samples. Bottom of the table, we've got the lowest ranked ones from 87 to 90. And what you'll see, now if you know anything about Scottish English, Edinburgh English, you'll know that some of these features are considered very salient by human listeners. So fronted goose, centralized kit. That shouldn't really be strut. Well, okay, we won't go into the details. There's funny things going on with the strut and foot vowels, which involve a lack of contrast between the foot vowel and the goose vowel. I don't want to go there really. Production of the goat vowel, rhoticity, and then the use of wh for WH initial words, which nobody did. So clearly that's not considered a special diagnostic of deception. But what I want to draw your attention to is the fact that you've got more ticks in the top half of the table than in the bottom. You've got more crosses lower down. So these are the things that people didn't do and were picked up for being fakes as a result, perhaps. So are some accent features more important than others? Well, no surprise for human listeners. Apparently, yes, that's the case. But we need to do more research on that question because that's much more difficult to unpack than what we saw in the previous results. Okay, so just to wrap up then, I'm really interested in people's ability to perform vocal imitations. And the skills that you need to do that successfully are quite diverse in nature. So I've trained actors in the past to do different accents and dialects of English. Great fun, but a lot of them don't want to use the methods that you would use in a phonetics class for university students. They were very resistant, many of them, to learning symbols of the IPA or finding out about vocal tract anatomy or any of that stuff. Many of them hated it. And yet, some of them are absolutely fantastic mimics. They had the fine detail down, they were really good. My question then is, well, what are they doing? How are they acquiring this knowledge, this skill? It's not by reading about it in books or knowing the theory. So I think there's value in trying to plug those two approaches together and seeing what works for people who do it in a non-academic sense and ones who are doing studying it for more intellectual reasons. The cognitive impression model, this is a kind of anchorage, theoretically, for some of the work that we want to pursue in the future. We think this combination of human and machine analysis is a potentially very powerful one. And it may be that we're actually not given a lot of option in the forensic context of having to try to integrate those sorts of approaches. For sociophonetics, well, it's also a useful new addition to the toolkit. I don't think it supersedes anything. That would be overly hasty. But when it comes to innovations in the methodology that we use for doing sociophonetic research, I think we've got a whole kind of vista of virgin territory in front of us right now. For the forensics group, I think the practical considerations are going to be pretty difficult to overcome in some cases. Getting hold of the databases of recordings of genuine speakers is going to be really time-consuming, really expensive. And once you've got the material, it has a limited shelf life because, of course, accents and dialects change all the time. So it's arguably not very useful if you've got a case involving speakers from, say, Nottingham or something. You know, you might find that there's a corpus of Nottingham English out there somewhere, but it was made in the 50s. Okay, it's not current anymore. As a kind of a part of the triage process, I suppose, with incoming recordings, being able to apply some kind of fairly coarse-grained initial assessment vis-a-vis what sort of accent group we're talking about, a system of the Yaktis type could be worth its weight in gold, really useful part of the battery of tests. And one or two ideas that we're batting around at the moment is actually to look at an even more specific form of imitation, which is impersonation of individuals. I've worked on a few cases which involve that. And I wonder how much mileage there would be in trying to see how well a system like Yaktist can spot when somebody's faking somebody else's voice, not just their accent, but their actual voice. And that's all I have to say. Thanks very much.